guess I have to answer that question because so far I guess I've written all the lyrics. I don't know. It was the most lyrics come from when I look at the news and all the stuff that is going on in the world, and something like really annoys me or grabs me, or like I can't stop thinking about it. It's like some way to get some thoughts out of my head for like and do something productive with it. So we have like a song like God Shit is about when Pussy Riot were incarcerated in Russia, and like it was a lot of different things. Like when you look at the last 4 years we are playing now, it's like all the stuff that that you've heard of that went wrong somewhere. Like Iron Maidan is about like the crisis in the Ukraine, and that was written like right when everything started there, like when people were protesting on the Maidan and like got shot and nobody really knew what was going on, and Russia invaded and all that. All that shit is like in our lyrics, but like I wouldn't say that like they are activist lyrics or something, because it's like you hear something, you have a certain feeling about it, and it's like a way of expressing them. Because like someone once asked like if it wouldn't be a little pointless to write about what is going wrong in the world, because you're only going with those lyrics to people who already think in kind of the same way. So like you're not changing anything by like complaining about what is going on and what is going wrong in the world. But I think it's kind of a good way to like blow some steam off. And like the name of the band is Violent Frustration, and it's I guess it came from the Arab Spring, like when a lot of people suddenly felt empowered to go out on the streets and protest against bad things in the world and like their governments, and it was like this feeling of change that was, sometimes it works and sometimes it gets even worse, and it's like the stuff we see every day. We'll be right back. I don't know. There is a lot of bands who have lyrics like this, political lyrics, and I mean, everyone can do what they want to do, but I think when you're a band and you sing about something, it's like you're commenting on something. But if you have the impression that you're changing something with that, there is better ways to change the world than to play grindcore and sing about it. And I don't know, maybe this is blasphemous, but I think it's my honest opinion. I don't know what you guys think about it. It's like the first thing for us is like we want to play this kind of music because we like it and it's fun to play. And the lyric part is like it fits the music really well and it's like really honest lyrics. But that's about it. I guess like when you want to change something, you have to go out in the street and protest and demonstrate. That really changes something. So I get like that you say it could be like perceived as nihilistic, but the lyrics don't say that you can't change anything. It's just like the lyrics say I'm pissed out, I'm really pissed off about something. And what you do with it is your thing. So, like, you could see it as an empowerment, as a comment. And I guess that's what a lot of grindcore bands do. But, like, that's about it. Like, that's where the line is between your lyrics and what you do afterwards. That is a completely different thing. Like, it's a position and a comment. And I guess sometimes we don't even agree 100%, like, in the band. I remember that we had a song about the terror attack at Charlie Hebdo. That was Je suis fuck you, and we had a discussion afterwards because Je suis fuck you is a song text that was really impulsive and is written from the point of view of someone who is like. Who's not in the focus of the public, who is maybe chased by Boko Haram or anything like that was not related to that, but like there's a lot of people every day who suffer and who have to die because of various things, but they don't get the attention that Charlie Hebdo people got. And I know and I understand that people could say that this is like an insult to the people who died at Charlie Hebdo, but I don't think it like this way. I think it's totally honest if someone expresses their thoughts about this, like when they like on Facebook when everyone was changing the profile pictures. It's like it's good that something like this happens, but it should happen like every day when someone dies like for reasons that they couldn't change, and like it would be really great if anyone else could get this kind of attention. Like, but yeah, if you look at the lyrics like they are right now, you could also see like, oh, they should not complain about Charlie Hebdo, it's not that bad because everyone else is suffering too. But that is not the way I see it. This is there's something maybe the lyrics like ignite discussion about it, and that's a good thing, I guess.
This means fuck you.
Thank you.
sometimes really strange because people tend to compare you to other bands, and what you get to hear is pretty wide. I heard like Brutal Truth, I heard like Nasum comes often, Terrorizer, what do we also have, Boltfrost, stuff like that, but yeah, it's pretty funny how two people compare you to other bands. Sometimes you think like, why? Brutal Truth is stuff like that. Brutal Truth to me is really complicated music, which is, I don't know, very technical, and we are straight. We are basically a pretty straight band, and it doesn't work for me to compare us to Brutal Truth.
I guess the Brutal Truth comparison was on the festival where I forgot a whole song.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what the song was and just played a blast beat, and like, I guess that sounded like Brutal Truth.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because no one else said that afterwards.
It was the Chaos Traum Festival.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That was the first festival we ever played at.
And it was the first gig, and for a long time, the only gig we were playing outside of Berlin. The first 2 years we were playing like 20 times in Berlin or something like that.
Yeah.
I don't know, it was really easy to get concerts in Berlin. You had many people who were making many shows, two or three a week in Berlin. And they were kind of asking us, and we were always like, we wanted to play live. We really liked it. It was the first year. It was nice to have to get a feeling for playing live and in small clubs and something like that.
Yeah, I guess we are. I don't know. We keep a list of the gigs we played, and I think we're at like 55 gigs right now. And yeah, it's still fun to play live, but it's also. Like as Chris said, we played in Berlin quite often, so after a while you see the same faces all the time. And Berlin is kind of, there's so many concerts going on that when you know that a band is playing like in the next 3 months for like five times in your town, you're not going there anymore because like it's nothing new then. So yeah, I guess we decided to have a little Berlin break and just play some concerts in Berlin now and like try to get out a little more. And that's, I guess that's the most fun part for me, like to go someplace else, play the music and meet the people who like to do the same. It was the same with when Warm Up came to town. It's like so cool to meet these people from like the other side of the world. And they're just like us and just want to play and have a great time then.
Future of the band, I guess this year we will try to write new songs. We are already writing new songs, got a bunch of them, and don't play too much live. We are trying to find places where we haven't played since then, like Robert already said, we are playing in Belgium this year, and we are trying to get other
concert venues, like, I don't know how many times we will play live this year, 4 or 5 times, I guess, for the rest of the year, and concentrate on record stuff and make new songs. But I guess that's our plan for this year, and I don't think that we are planning much more ahead, I guess, just watch what will come and take it, yeah, the way it comes, I guess, yeah.
Yeah, so if anyone wants us to play in their hometown, please contact us.
As long as you're not from Berlin.
Yeah, that happens, like, anyways.
One long player was the latest. It's called Peace Was Now an Option, and the first EP was We Live in Hell. The second EP with all four guys, with Great Power Comes Great Mayhem. That was just jamming, Robert and I, and was like, okay, I don't know.
Maybe, yeah, the beginning, like the first EP that we recorded, that was really just jamming, like two people, like Toby and me, and I guess it was like on the first session it was 5 songs or something, so we just had fun and like did something new, and I had some old lyrics laying around, and we put them just on the songs and sounded kind of cool, so we like repeated this like 2 or 3 sessions after that, so we had this We Live in Hell EP, but we didn't have a band, so we looked for some people to actually have a functioning live band, and yeah, we found them like 3 months after that. But on the first one, it was just like the two people. We actually split the vocals on that one, and when we became a whole band, like with 4 people, it was like the classic way of writing music. It was like 4 people in a room, one had an idea and the other 3 improved or said, no, that's stupid, we don't play that. And in the end we had like a second EP after like half a year, I guess.
Yeah, it was like
the first 2 EPs were very close after each other, and yeah, like we didn't even think about like going to a label or something like that. We just like sat at home and cut the booklets ourselves and burned all the CDs and did all that ourselves and just put them out for like, I don't know, €2 or something. Mm-hmm. So that we had something to give to people on the concerts. And like for the most part it was a live band with some records in stock, but like we always play the new songs first live, and then at some point you can get them on a CD. And it was kind of the same thing with the album then, because the album was, it took a little longer time, and for the first time we did not do the mix ourselves. We gave the whole material that we recorded, I guess, in this room. Was it in this room or was it in the old room?
It was in the old room.
Oh yeah. We gave the material to a friend who is from Sweden, and he did the mixing and the mastering for us. And that was kind of a new thing to do, because like before that we did everything ourselves and like did the best we could. But yeah, he did a pretty great job. And after that we had like a 25 minute long player that we actually still a little proud of, I guess.
Yeah. That was also the reason why we started writing to record companies, not really record companies like Universal or stuff like that. It was just like, what record companies do we know? What do we know? Who sells stuff or something like that? And then we did just write them if they want to produce our stuff, because we were really proud of it. We thought, yeah, that was something great that we made here. So we really only just took some addresses or stuff like that and did just write them, yeah. Some were interested, some didn't answer, and one did answer yes, he would really like to make this stuff. And we met him at a festival where he was also, and we were talking about it. In first place, he wasn't really, he didn't like the first mixing because it wasn't finished what we did send to the record companies. But when it was finished, he was really fine with it, and he made the LPs and stuff like that, yeah. It was really a great experience to have a real LP in your hand from your stuff, yeah, it was great.
From our long play.
This is the Oberhaus, and it's what is E4?
It was in when the German, what was it called? Fuck, DDR English.
Yeah, it was a tape factory.
Yes, in times of the German
Democratic Republic.
Yes, yes.
Time.
Yeah, and Orbo is now a EV Eigentragenverein.
Yeah, no idea what that means.
Okay, there's like a company of guys who made this with all.
It's, I don't know, 100 rooms or something?
More, I think 200.
Really?
It's, yeah, it's Berlin's biggest, I think, 200 rehearsal rooms in this whole complex. Yeah, it's Berlin's biggest and the loudest block in Berlin called.
Yeah, it's kind of a cool place because you don't really have neighbors in the vicinity, so you can like play 24/7, yeah. Like as loud as you want, as long as you keep the windows closed. Yeah, it's kind of a good thing. It's kind of a drive out here, but yeah.
Some really great, well named bands like Silvermond, I think it's some German rock pop band, and some other really, really great bands are playing here. And there's from hip hop to everything.
Yeah, you got everything. You got death metal, you got punk rock, you got hip hop, everything, I guess. Yeah, ska bands are also here. Yes.
There's also a record studio, I think two, here in this room, own catering area with a bar. Like a pub, and you can also play concerts there if you want. You have to ask, maybe we can play. Yeah, sure, no problem. There's another concert place once in a year. They make a big festival, the Orbo Festival. Yeah, it's, and a workshop for repair stuff and everything.
It's a premiere, it's the first time.
Yeah, it's a new
anyone
one.
Yeah. Here's a song.
We never know what happens.
Yeah. That's the reason why we need a lyric.
Basic thing in our lyrics, like we have some other topics, like on the first records we had some actually funny ones about some weird news I read, but I can't quite remember right now, but like the
Literally Boned, I guess.
Oh yeah.
You mean it?
Yeah, Literally Boned was about some weird criminal case in Gothenburg in Sweden. Mm-hmm. We have a friend from Gothenburg who is playing a guitar solo on that song, and it was about there was some woman who kept some bones of some person in her apartment, and I don't know how she did that, but like apparently she had like sex with the bones or used them for like purposes like this. So it's one of the song that was written from the view of the skeleton. It's like, yeah, it's kind of a weird thing that's going on here. But it's like really the first, I guess the first songs were like, we did not have a plan where to go, and like we had some weird lyrics in the beginning, but like right now it's not that funny anymore in the lyrics. So it's like a lot of serious topics. I guess. What were the last songs we did? Like the newest ones?
Maybe we can talk about that.
Beasts of Belgium.
Beasts of Belgium, yeah.
Oh yeah, Beasts of Belgium is a quite new one, but we have never played that live. But we have a concert in Belgium, like in May, and the plan is to play there for the first time. Like I guess it's the first new song we've played live after like 2 years or something. And it's about the Marc Dutroux case.
Okay.
And because that was kind of the topic that when I read about it, I was like, what? How is this possible? It's like insane. And yeah.
Just do one more. Yeah.
It's your choice. Pick one.
I'm not sure it's here. I like it.
Okay. It's about drugs.